tried some online, early online web lead generation, and it was stupid. I mean, talk about throwing money away, throwing time away. I would never hire a real estate agent who considered me a lead, you know, who called me off a lead list. I would never hire that person.
Welcome to In the Blue Zone, the real estate marketing podcast where difference makers and influencers from around Coldwell Banker discuss how to enjoy success, find inspiration, earn more money, and have fun building a business.
Welcome to In the Blue Zone with Jennifer Allan-Hagedorn. Hopefully I said that correctly.
Hey, that's awesome. Good job.
And we are really excited to have a conversation with Jennifer. She has a long experience with real estate and other things we're going to hear about, which I'm personally very excited about. I first heard of Jennifer when I was taking a continuing ed class in Pennsylvania, of all things, and the class was referencing one of her works throughout it. And the class was Selling to Your Sphere, which is an unfortunate title, but I think the intent was there. And so I just became very, very impressed with her work and connected with Jennifer. And we thought it'd be great to have her on the podcast to share some of the things that she's learned along the way in real estate and other industries. And so welcome, Jennifer. So that's a very brief introduction from what I know of you. But if you could give us just a little bit more about your past, or maybe how you got to this point in 2022.
Sure. Well, I started selling real estate when I was 29 in Denver, Colorado, and I practiced real estate for 12 years, had a reasonably successful career. I mean, I think most people on the call today would probably say, yeah, I'll take that. I'm not going to say I lit the world on fire and I was Denver's number one real estate agent, but I think what's interesting about my story is how I did it, how I was successful in real estate without, I can give you the, you know, sort of the punchline is I never cold called. I never knocked on a stranger's door. I never went after a for sale by owner. I really did almost no traditional prospecting throughout my career. And not because necessarily I didn't want to do it. It didn't sound like fun to me. It didn't sound like something that would work. And because the traditional prospecting techniques, now remember, this was back in the 90s and the early 2000s. We didn't have, you know, all this online stuff, but the traditional prospecting techniques would not have worked on me. And so why was I going to go out and do it to other people thinking this was going to work? So the quick resume is my first year I sold 25 houses. I was rookie of the year runner-up in Coldwell Banker, for that matter. Not like national Coldwell Banker or anything, but the Coldwell Banker along the Front Range. And then my biggest year was 70 houses. Most years I sold around 50. So, you know, most agents I think would think, yeah, that's all right. I'll take that. And, but again, I never did any traditional prospecting. I really didn't do any prospecting at all, at least as far as, you know, anyone would call prospecting. So that was where the class came from, that we referenced of, you know, selling to your sphere of influence. And I think that's a lot of what we're going to talk about today, but we'll end up coming back to some central themes that you'll see evolve. But yeah, let's go. Let's talk about it.
So today, I also want to mention that after you left real estate, you started a dog rescue in Pensacola, mm-hmm. where you are now, which mm-hmm. you said, when our first conversation, you said there was a lot of similarities, which really struck a chord with me. And it made me think, you know, like what similarities are there? Of course, I kind of know what you're going to say. But you know, I think it's again a central theme here is sphere. That's the theme of this interview, this episode. But you know, I'm just curious, like what are the similarities sure. that strike you about the two?
Okay, so I am the president and founder of what I believe is the largest private dog and cat rescue in the Northwest Florida Panhandle. And I just started it one day, almost kind of like how I started real estate. And there are a lot of similarities. It's a small business. It's not a volume business. And I think that's really important to remember in real estate. And if you want to start a dog rescue, I can tell you all about that. It's not a volume business. It's, as I say in real estate, it's one warm body at a time that you bring into your world. Dog rescues the same thing. It's one new volunteer. It's one new foster. It's one new, you know, donor. It's not 20, 30, 40 at a time. And to me, that's one of the central themes of a successful sphere of influence-based business, whether that's real estate or massage therapy or dog training or dog rescuing or wedding photography or it's not a volume business. The other thing that is just critical to me is the word we used when we had the conversation earlier is organic and natural. Everything you do to build your business needs to be organic and natural to you. I mentioned a little while ago that, you know, when I built my real estate business, I didn't do things I didn't want to do. I didn't do things that didn't feel natural or organic. They didn't sound like fun, and I knew I wouldn't do them. And if I did them, I wouldn't do them well. So everything I did to build my real estate business felt good to me, felt organic, felt natural. And that includes working with my sphere of influence. So I'm not saying I didn't do the other prospecting things. I did try expired listings. I tried some online, early online web lead generation. And it was stupid. I mean, talk about throwing money away, throwing time away. I would never hire a real estate agent who considered me a lead, you know, who called me off a lead list. I would never hire that person. And so, you know, I was like, okay, then why am I doing this to people? When I started in real estate back in 1996 with Global Banker, they wanted me to send out what eventually became known in my world as the dorky announcement letter. They wanted me to send this little, sorry, Global Banker, blue and white little note card that said, the agent whose card is enclosed has entered the wonderful world of real estate and they're fabulous and they know everything about everything and their company is wonderful and, you know, give them a call and if you have any referrals. And, you know, I looked at this and I went, if I got this, what would I do with it? You know, I'd throw it in the trash. So that kind of began, and this was back in 1996, of, okay, what would I respond to? What could a real estate agent send to me as an announcement that would make me smile and think of them fondly and maybe even hold on to the card? So where was I going with that? I don't know.
I want to know the answer to that question.
Right. Well, you know, I can tell you, maybe that's our next show, but, if you ask yourself every time you're considering a business building, I don't call it prospecting, I call it business building, but you know, how does your gut feel about it? Would this work on me? Does this make me feel silly to do it? Does it make me feel icky to do it? If it does, it's not the right activity for you and it's not going to work for you. Now, there are real estate trainers out there who preach something completely different from me. And guess what? It probably worked for them. You know, I mean, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with any of these other prospecting activities, but they didn't work for me. Now, if you, you know, go to a seminar, and I don't even know who the big teachers are today, but if you were to go to a seminar and they're telling you all about knocking on doors or cold calling people or web leads or whatever, and you're like, wow, yeah, yes, that sounds like fun. That sounds like, you know, great. That'll work for you. If you're going, all right, well, then it's not, you know, find something else. So
you said that you're not a system person. I think we had an original call. You said, you know, you have a system too. I mean, everyone has a system. That's called, like I said, business building is a good summary of that, right? But what are the essentials for you? And, you know, we had talked a little bit about how you acquire new business. The things that you do, like what are the actual activities that you would recommend to somebody? You know, your book, by the way, your website's called Selling with Soul, right? Sellwithsoul.com. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the rest of you is called Saving with Soul. So just, yeah. What was the
specific activities that you would say start out with and how do you continue after you've started that? Like, what? You know, it's pretty simple, I think, what you share with me.
When we talk about systems, I'm going to back up for a minute. I sold real estate training stuff for a living for about 10 years. So I sold books, I sold programs, I sold systems, I sold, you know, all this stuff. And what was funny is when I went back and looked at what I did to be successful, it wasn't a system, it wasn't a tool, it wasn't a program, it wasn't any of that. It was a commitment. This is going to sound so dorky, a commitment to excellence. And what I mean by that is not excellent prospecting, is to serving my clients as my number one priority, as my first priority, as what woke me up at night, what kept me going during the day, is being an amazing real estate agent, the best real estate agent I could possibly be. Okay, that's the driving force. That's the passion. When I read books about being successful in real estate, it's all about passion for prospecting, passion for referrals. And for me, it was a passion to be an exceptional real estate agent. And that's what really drove me. And I can tell you, honestly, if you have that passion to be an exceptional real estate agent and your antenna's up reasonably when you're out and about, you do a reasonably good job staying in touch with people, and reasonably good is really not that hard. Your business will be successful. Will you sell 200 houses a year? Probably not. But you know what? You know why you're not selling 200 houses a year? Because you're taking care of your clients. And you're taking great care of them. And you probably couldn't do that for 100 or 200 clients a year. I'll give you another secret. If you have 200 clients a year, which is fine if you want that business model, you're not getting all that money. You're paying, for a lot of help. So I did decide at the peak of my career, I did decide I can't have all this help. Help takes a lot of time, takes a lot of money. I ended up saying, okay, I'm going to do what I can do by myself and a little bit of help. Totally got off.
That's so interesting, right? I mean, there's a sweet spot that every agent is going to fall into at some point where, what number makes, and we know this in our heads, but we don't really talk about it much, but what's the point where they can sell enough with excellent service, excellent everything,
for me,
and not have to pay for help?
For me personally,
right?
That was 50. I could do 50 a year. And I had a little bit of help, not a ton, but a little bit of help. I could do 50 houses a year, more or less. And to me, that if you break that out by how many months of the year, there's 12 months in the year. If you can't do four deals a month, you should be able to do four deals a month without, losing your mind. So to me, 50 is a very comfortable number.
Yeah.
If I get up more than that, it's too much. Anyway, back to the subject of your sphere of influence. What do you do every day if you want to say, I want to be just
right,
like Jennifer, and I want to run a sphere of influence-based business? And when I say that, I mean all of my business came from people I knew and people I met. Did it come from my best friend? No. Did it? That's not how it works. It's not that your little core of 20 people out there is doing all your prospecting for you. It's that every time you're out in the world, and a lot of that you're going to be out in the world doing real estate because that's what you're doing, is taking exceptional care of your clients. But you come out into the world, you behave yourself like a reasonably competent human being. You're not pushing people. You're not driving them away. You're not a predator. Oh my gosh, who do you know that wants to buy or sell real estate today? You're out there in the world being a professional real estate agent. And the people that you encounter out there while you're doing that are going to notice and they're going to remember. So one of the conversations we had that I'm very passionate about is when you're in the middle of a real estate transaction, okay, you are the buyer's agent or the listing agent, whichever one. You are the center of attention in a lot of ways. So if you add up all of the other human beings who are a part of that real estate transaction and they are all watching you, that is serious sphere of influencing. So you've got your buyer, your buyer's family, your buyer's spouse, your buyer's friends, your buyer's lender, the appraiser, the lender, the inspector, the seller. Anyone who's involved in this transaction is watching you. And if you're doing a good job and getting the job done, taking care of business, every single person in that transaction is noticing. And they can be a tremendous source of business for you. Even the other agent. Okay. The other agent can be a source of business for you if they're impressed with you. There was an agent in my REMAX office who said, I love it when you're the agent on the other side of the deal, because I know it's going to close. And dang, that was nice to hear.
I love when you said that on the call that me that what good is a amazing closing gift when you gave them mediocre service? So that was a great comment.
All of these things something I meant to say earlier was, you know, I sold real estate training stuff. And what I really have to say is not marketable. Nobody's going to pay me for it as a real estate trainer. And it's back to this, just be a good real estate agent, be decent to people, be nice to people, have a follow-up system in place, not to remind them of your affection for referrals, but when you have conversations with people, whether they're friends, family, clients, anybody, have some little reminder system of something you talked about that you can follow up with them. I mean, here's an example of this morning, and I fail miserably at this, I'll tell you. But a friend of mine in the rescue, she had to euthanize one of our dogs this morning, one of our rescue dogs. I knew it. She told me at 7 o'clock this morning that at 8:30 she had this appointment to euthanize this dog, and it was breaking her heart. And I said, oh, I'm so sorry. So 10 o'clock comes along, I get a text right before we go on. She goes, Titan's gone, he went peacefully. I'm like, I'd already forgotten. You know, what if I had written that down or put it in my smartphone or an index card and said, hey, check in with Courtney at 9:30 and see how it went. And the opportunities to do that with our friends, colleagues, family, you could do that all day long. You know, somebody tells you something at 8 o'clock in the morning and you check in with them at 5 to see how it went. I don't remember to do that. But when I do, you know, and if I were building a real estate business, I bet you could run a business just on doing that. You know, being a decent person who cares about other people. As long as you're a good real estate agent. Really nice person who cares a lot about people. But if you're not a good real estate agent, you're going to be mediocrely successful.
You are right, though. Those little comments, and that's just human nature. You know, you remember, you felt lonely in that moment, but this person remembered you. Like, wow, that made me feel like something in my heart, which makes you automatically inclined to gravitate towards that person. So that's great.
And if you're going to say, gee, my business model in 2022 is to be a better friend.
Yeah.
And do that. Do you know what that would do for your business? And, you know, call it mercenary if you want. I don't care. But you got to build your business somehow. And hey, how about doing it by being a really good friend, being a really good wife, being a really, you know, whatever.
I'm thinking about, you know, practicalities, right? So I think up to this point, I think everybody would feel that's listening to this would be like, yeah, I want that. Like, I want that satisfaction. I want that job, the job satisfaction. I already know I have to be a great agent, and there's ways to do that. And I have lots of resources for that. And I also want to be, you know, a better friend. I think that sounds more appealing to me than calling people or whatever thing. So what are the next steps? Someone wants to start tomorrow morning being, you know, on this journey. How do they build a sphere? Like, what specific activities do they do or should they try to, you know, embark on this mission of building something that way?
Okay. One of the biggest questions that I get, and you even asked me this question when we talked before, was, I have this database of 200 names or 300 names. How do I get back in touch with them? How do I, you know, make them my sphere of influence? And I struggled over that question for years because I got asked it all the time and I felt like I needed to have some snappy, brilliant answer to it. But I came back again to, well, what would work for me? Well, what if, you know, somebody I barely knew went into real estate and they wanted to connect with me and get all my business and referrals? And I'm like, I got nothing. I don't know. So, you know, you do your best. You do an announcement to everybody you know. Non-dorky announcement, which is a topic for another day. Some of the people will respond, some of them won't. You want to start a mailing program? Fine, start a mailing program. I that's not going to make or break your career, but fine, do it. But it's more of an antenna up strategy, attitude of if I have an opportunity to connect with a person face to face, voice to voice, email to email, take it and make, but organically. So, you know, the 300 people in your database, 250 of them maybe barely remember you. Are you going forward, get out in the world and do what I call be pleasant to 10 people a day? Okay. Now, another strategy to contrast with the be pleasant to 10 people a day is the go out into the world and don't you come home until you have a buyer or seller. That's another approach. And that's a perfectly fine approach for somebody else, not for me. But, you know, go out in the world and you talk to people until you have yourself a buyer or seller and don't you come home until you have it. Okay. I'm not going to do that, but more power to somebody that does. My approach is to go out in the world and build your sphere of influence. So I'm going to go out and be pleasant to 10 people a day. Am I going to come home with a buyer or a seller? Probably not. Maybe I will, but that's not the goal. The goal is to meet 10, to be pleasant to 10 people with the goal. I don't want to put it into numbers, but let's go ahead. Put it that one person you're pleasant to every day becomes somebody you communicate with again in your life for some reason. Okay, so 9 of the people you were pleasant to, you'll never see again, you'll never hear from them. One person a day becomes someone that becomes a member of your sphere of influence on some level. Okay, you do that every day for a year, you know, you've got 365 people who remember you fondly, you know, probably had a decent interaction with you because you started off by being pleasant. 365 people is a lot of people. Okay. So that's a start and that's an attitude. And so do you, as soon as you meet this person and you're pleasant to them, do you ask them for their contact information? No, you don't. Again, don't chase them off. 1 out of 10 may be somebody that you're, you know, you want to get together with, you get their card, you give them your card. It may be over dog rescue. It may be over sushi. It may be over, you know, you both like beer. I don't know. Doesn't have to be over real estate because most of these people you're being pleasant to have absolutely no interest in you as a real estate agent. And that's okay. So you go out and you do that, which of course gets easier every day you do it. And as you start to have success, you do the best you can, keeping track of who these people are. You take your little notes and you just organically build relationships with people that can be very superficial. Superficial. I mean, if you think about who you refer people to, whether that's for real estate, mortgage, bro, you know, whatever, do you refer to them because they're your best friend? Hardly, you probably don't refer to any of your best friends. It's people that you know how to reach them, you think highly of them, you're pretty sure they'll do a good job. And, you know, and you certainly don't refer people that you feel sorry for. You know, oh my gosh, this person's really struggling. They really, you know, they really need some business. I think I'll send someone that way. So, you know, it's getting back in your head and remembering how you choose service providers. How do you refer people? And behaving, being that real estate agent that you would refer somebody to and behaving in ways that put you in places for that to happen. Super marketable. I can't package this up and sell this to you.
But it's something that I think everybody has in their, I think everybody knows this, like any human being in our community knows this, right? So it's just kind of being a business person, human being 101 or something. It's like, yeah, it's not a system per se, but so just to kind of recap. So you're looking at being pleasant to 10 people today as a strategy, having an antenna up strategy, like those two things kind of working hand in hand. Having a system that you're taking notes on people so that you don't forget the moment that you literally talk to them, right? So that's something that is going to be an ongoing process that's never going to stop. It's okay to do an announcement as long as it's not too dorky. We already covered that. But, you know, and having some kind of a strategy to let them know that you, you know, are an agent, but not being overbearing because you wouldn't want to receive that yourself in any way, shape, or form. So then, and I think I asked you this on our last call, like, you know, to building on that, like, this is like, you know, it's great, but then now you have 10, 15, 200, 300 people in there, you know, what do you recommend as far as ideas to stay in touch with them without it being like formulaic, I guess.
Okay. I'm going to go back to the antenna up theory is the vast majority of your business is not going to come from people that you're mailing to. Some will. you're going to get business because you're out in the world being a great real estate agent. Now, I get it. If you have no business and nobody to be a great real estate agent for, then, you know, this is not helpful. But I will reiterate that if you are in active real estate with 3 or 4 or 5 clients going on, you know, just focus on them. They're going to give you business. You don't have to go to lunch. You don't have to do mailings. You don't have to do anything except focus on your clients and those little kind of mini spheres that you've got going on in your active transactions. What was the question?
Building on, but
okay, right. So what I recommend that agents do, and this is what I did, and you know, it wasn't the cornerstone of my career, but I did it and I felt good that I did it because I was doing something, is I did 6 communications a year. More or less. During my busy times, I may not have done all of this. But anyway, what I do is 2 postal mailings a year. One I did in January, I called the Happy New Year letter. And that was a physical letter I sent out about me and my year. And I mean, something reasonably interesting, you know, I thought anyway about me. You know, the Happy New Year letter. And then what else did I do? Sometime in the middle of the year, if I had time and I thought about it, I'd send out some other doodad through the mail. You know, something, I don't know, maybe postal rates are going up. I would send, I don't know. And then at the end of the year, I would do my end of the year doodad, you know, whether that's going to be a magnet or a calendar or, you know, something like that. So actually, so 3 doodads a year through the mail. And then a big thing for me, which honestly, I don't know if this works anymore, but it did for me, was mass emails. And so I would send out an email to my mailing list every 6 weeks to 2 months. Again, interesting. I have samples of these on my website. Not, please send me referrals, not, oh, the time's changing, you know, okay. But 6 interesting, non-referral begging, non-dorky, non-canned, non-pre-written mass emails. The goal of the mass emails, and maybe you guys, there's a different format for this now, is to start conversation. And so if I send out a mass email and it's about street sweeping in Denver, which is something that happens every April, and you get a ticket if your car is on the wrong side of the street in Denver. So I would send out a mass email every April and say, hey, go outside, look at the sign in front of your house, see when your street sweeping day is, and remember, blah, blah, blah. People are going to respond to that and say, oh my God, thank you so much. I appreciate it. Yes, every year I get a ticket. Has nothing to do with real estate. It has to do with Denver, has nothing to do with real estate. And people will respond. So the goal of your communications, the mail stuff is mostly to remind them that you exist and get your, you know, your business card or whatever in their hands. The others are to start conversations. And is that now something you do on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram or I don't know. I feel like we're kind of in between communication right now. You know, we kind of, emails are not as cool, but I'm not sure what's taking its place, you know, anyway. But really, when I was busy, oh, and going to lunch with friends, my first year in real estate, my big thing was going to lunch with friends. And I'm an introvert. I didn't have a ton of friends, but I had enough to get started. And going to lunch for me is very comfortable. I can go to lunch. We can, you know, if we have to, we can drink some wine or whatever to get, you know, get things, get the party started. But I would go to lunch twice a week with a friend, and that was great for me. I think every lunch date ended up in some sort of business for me, but that's not why I was at lunch. And it's not taking your friends to lunch. You're not taking your friends to lunch and paying for it. You can, but that's not why you're going to lunch, is to pay for lunch and make them feel beholden to you. You're just going to lunch. They want to pay for it, let them pay for it. It's fine. You know, you pick it up the next time. So
is that part of being pleasant to 10 people? Mm-hmm. At least 2 of them.
Yeah, if you don't go to lunch with someone you don't want to go to lunch with. I don't call up my plumber or my dentist and say, hey, you're on my sphere of influence. I need to go to lunch with you. You know, you go to lunch with people you want to go to lunch with. You know, you're hanging out and somebody in your office is hanging out and you go, hey, you want to go, you know, want to go grab a taco. And you just get into the rhythm, get into the mode of antenna up for opportunities to connect with people organically. And it, it really works, and it really is that simple. And every time you do it, you're going to come away with, God forbid, I hate this word, a lead.
Yep. So, one thing I really love about what you said is that it's not a hard and fast rule, but you don't have to pay for lunch. As soon as you do that, it becomes, I'm taking my client out to lunch instead of I'm building a relationship. And I love that. I mean, I a realtor that I used to work with, she did a lot of the things that you're talking about, and was also very opposed to, you know, some of those things that just didn't feel comfortable that you usually talk about when you talk about marketing, like you're saying. But that building relationships and being a great real estate agent, it comes back to you. And it's also fun. Like you said, it's fun, it's rewarding, and it's not intimidating to say, oh, I have to have lunch with two people this week. Who are you going to enjoy? It's interesting because I was going to ask you two questions. One, are you a natural introvert, or what's your personality? And you answered that. And also, what did you do in the beginning? You kind of answered that too, just like going to lunch with people. And I love what you said too about the, you know, you're not going out today, and I'm not going to come back home until I get a buyer. Because it's really about planting seeds. And that's what strikes me as what you're doing, is you're planting seeds over time and cultivating them over time. And the expectation is that you will reap the reward down the road, but it doesn't have to be today. And when you put that pressure on any relationship, then it
could be today. And that's the thing is, I've had people say, I don't have the luxury of doing it your way. I need business now. And okay, I get that. But are you really going to go out there in the world and not come home until you found a buyer or seller? Is that really what you're going to do? If you're going to do it, then by all means, get yourself 7 buyers and sellers by the end of this week. But, you know, I don't know any better way to get a new client than being out there in the world where people are, and people know people and know other people. Will you get a new client this week? Maybe you will, maybe you won't, but most real estate agents are not going to do the beat the streets until you scare up a client for very long anyway.
Yeah.
And I've always wondered, and God bless them, you know, these people that prospect for 14 hours a day, and they're very successful. I mean, you know, good on them. But one, ick, gross. I mean, that, and who's taking care of their clients? So maybe they have this team that's taking care of them, you know, so be it. But I didn't get into real estate to prospect 14 hours a day, to knock on people's doors at 7 o'clock in the morning. And because that's when they're home, and that's, you know, that serves me. And I'm sure they're delighted to hear from me at 7 o'clock in the morning. You know, I got into it to be a really good real estate agent and be proud of the business that I'm building. So, and the money comes. I mean,
that's one of the interesting thing is, you know, real estate marketing is almost an oxymoron. Like, we're marketing professionals in the real estate space. Like, we're like, three of us are literally paid professionals within Coldwell Banker. And there's many other people like us that are supposed to do real estate marketing. That's our job. Then you say, well, what exactly is real estate marketing? You know, right. Now there's listing marketing. I mean, marketing and advertising are constantly conflated. And it just, I'm a business school grad. So it drives me nuts to, you know, advertising is not marketing. Marketing is a strategy. Advertising is a methodology or whatever.
Okay.
And so as real estate agents, you know, how do we market ourselves? Like, you know, it's you kind of go in a full circle and you stop immediately. Like, I don't know. And there's literally no good way to market. So it's really about being yourself. It's about, you know, building a brand. Like, these are things that marketers can get behind, right? You know, branding yourself, creating a brand that people recognize. It's recognizable in the community or whatever. So, but how do you do that? At the end of the day, it's got to come down to interpersonal connections that, you know, the best agents in your neighborhood are ones that everybody knows because they've made a lot of people happy over the years in their services. And that's the best real estate agent is from a marketing perspective. It doesn't matter how many billboards they bought or, you know, how many hundred people they call a week, because if they have 200 deals a month and they're all treating them like a, you know, like a factory and handing them off to their team. We have a couple of agents that I know of that not in our company, but, you know, I've seen over the years, people have done that and you get handed off to their people. And as soon as you sign a contract with them and you never see them again until settlement.
Yeah.
Like those people, you know, I mean, what kind of a message are they sending to their community? You know, so it's tough to quantify marketing, you know, but it's there, it lives.
Well, I always say that if your marketing strategy, advertising, marketing, I think marketing, if your marketing strategy is to get your name out there, okay, quote, get your name out there, just say no. Because you as a real estate agent do not have enough money to get your name out there to the point that it's going to make any difference. The people whose names are out there and who have billboard, recognizable billboards, the reason that works, get your name out there works if your name is already out there. If you've got real estate signs all over the neighborhood and then you start doing marketing, then it will work for you. It's name recognition, you know, and I'm not a marketing person, but, you know, new agents, oh, what can I do to get my name out there? Nothing. Nothing. Stop. It is not going to work and it's going to cost you a lot of money and time. So just stop. And they don't believe me and that's okay. They can go spend their money. But yeah, there's nothing a real estate agent can do to get their name out there except have their name out there because they're doing business.
Well, it's a good point. Your name is not just your first name and your last name. Your name is a reputation and they go side by side. And that sounds like what you're saying. You know, like you to get your name out there means to get your reputation out there. And so when people see your name on a billboard, they recognize it because they see your body of work or they're familiar with your body of work. And it's a really good point. Putting your name out there is not just putting your first and last name on a billboard next to your headshot.
And you say, ooh, that's the agent for me.
What a pretty headshot. I think I'll call them.
Yeah.
I think that kind of also goes hand in hand with what you were saying before. Like, would that work on me? Like, would that work on you if you saw someone's billboard? Oh, well, you know, maybe it does for some people, but like you said, maybe look internally and see how that would work for you. This is a great point. I was wondering though, so, you know, we're talking about beginning your business and how, you know, being a decent person is part of that. I was thinking, you know, I think Jeff had mentioned something before about your conversation, and how, you know, you go out and do what you love, a hobby, if that is, you know, maybe for Jeff, it's disc golf or someone else's golf, you know, but who knows, maybe it's a book club, maybe it's the moms on your kid's soccer team. But what did you do? You know, was there a hobby or a method that you had in that regards that gave you this?
I love that question. Okay. Interestingly, dog rescue is the first hobby I have ever had in my entire life. And I did not have that hobby when I was in real estate. So I have never, ever had a hobby. Now, hold that thought, is when I was in real estate, I did real estate. I mean, that's what I did. I loved it. I lived it. I breathed it. If I didn't have a client to work with, I was out previewing. So I've always been a workaholic. So my work has always been, if you want to call it, my hobby. However, I'm sure there were other things that came naturally to me that I did, but I don't know. If I were to do it now, absolutely, I call it bonding versus branding. Is if you want to build a community that will refer business to you by something that you love, a hobby, a passion, then sure, you can create the brand that says, I'm the dog saving realtor. I'm the bike riding realtor. I'm the disco golf, you know, playing realtor. And you can build a brand. You can market in the magazines. You can, you know, do all this stuff. Nobody cares. Go join the dog rescuing, the wine drinking, the soccer playing, the disco golf playing group. Become a part of that group. Become an active participating. I would have more business than I'd know what to do with because of the respect I built, you know, as a dog rescuer. And now when I was doing real estate, would I have had time to do dog rescue? Absolutely not. I was busy. One of the very simple examples that I shared with Jeff is if you like sushi, like you love sushi, and you go, there's a good sushi bar in your neighborhood, ideally the neighborhood that you specialize in, and you hang out at the sushi bar once or twice a week, you bring your clients there, you tip well, you get to know the regulars, you eat sushi because you like sushi. Sushi people think other sushi people are cool. And so if I'm a regular at the sushi bar and I'm eating my raw fish and I know what I'm doing, other sushi people are going to notice and they're going to feel like you have something in common. So it's, you know, find your cheers. If, you know, craft beer or whatever other things people eat that's kind of weird or drink, not weird, but that other, where other people happen to be. Now, maybe it's, you know, cornhole, you know, darts, you know, whatever. And hang out there, be a pleasant contributing member of the society. You don't have to bring your real estate card with you. Become somebody these other people are aware of. They think you're pretty cool. And eventually real estate will come up. So it's a lifestyle. It's, you know, being a great real estate agent who also happens to be a pretty decent human being.
I love that because there's no end to that list of what that thing is. Just enjoying sushi was just an example right there. And I could have somebody come to my head right now, even just being a parent on the PTO or something like
exactly.
that. It, you know, it's something that you're passionate about and
the band mom. I mean, all these things. Yeah.
Being
by the way, it's disc golf, not disco golf. Okay. I'll just say that. Okay.
And I thought, wow, that's really funny. So it's going to be disco golf for me forever now. Sorry.
That's so funny.
You know, like, we started something, unfortunately, now, I think for me.
Disco golf.
I wanted to ask you, is there ever a time when, like, I get the impression from you that it's easy, that you just go out and every day you just be pleasant to 10 people and you take two people to lunch a week. But is there a time where you do, because you said you're an introvert, is there a time when you do have to push yourself? Like, you don't want to be nice to 10 people today, but, you know,
that's a great question.
But you do have to push through the feeling of somebody's not wanting to do it.
No. Yes and no. But no, in that I never do anything I'm uncomfortable doing. So if, you know, something that, like, I've had people tell me they don't find lunch comfortable. They you know, introverts, you know, that, oh, wow, that just sounds horrible. First, I explain to them, you only go to lunch with people you actually want to go to lunch with, that you look forward to it. You don't want to cancel. You're looking forward to reconnecting with this person. So, you know, it's not a struggle at all to do the things that I'm saying you do. And you figure out what those are. If something is just way too uncomfortable, out of your comfort zone, then don't do it. Find something that is comfortable. Do I have crabby days? Sure. And I would say, like, I remember there was a time in my career that I wasn't doing very well. I was scared. I was frustrated. It was, you know, some dark days. And I took someone to lunch or went to lunch with someone, and I complained to her the whole time. And I came away from that going, let's not do that again. Because if you're in a really bad mood, you know, that's probably not the time to go to lunch, especially if you're scared, if you're, you know, if you're frustrated. The mood will probably pass. On the other hand, you know, I can get stuck at home for days on end. And as an introvert, I'm fine with that. And then I go out in the world and it's like, okay, yeah, I need people too. You know, I need to have these connections. So, you know, do I go out in the world when I'm crabby and try to be pleasant? I mean, give it a shot. If it's not working for you, you know, go back home. It's all right. but, you know, when you're going out being pleasant to 10 people, I also call this put on your sexy jeans, is you want to be out there in the world like, you know, I look good. You know, I look appropriate. I'm not pulling my little short skirt down, you know, to because I, you know, I didn't dress properly or something. I teach introverts, and that really wasn't something we were going to talk about, but it is something. I have so many hints and tips for introverts to have relationships with people that are comfortable for you. Another tip, just real quick, is to wear something conversational. So if you have something on your body that will inspire other people to say something to you, great. Or look for other people. You know, that they have something on their body. You know, when I lived in Denver, if somebody had a Kansas City Chiefs shirt on in Denver, you know, I'm from Kansas City. I'm a Denver fan, you know, so that would, you know, if somebody has a Kansas City Chiefs thing on in Denver, it's something I can say, hey, I'm from Kansas City. But, you know, wearing something conversational or looking for it on other people, walking your dog. You know, huge prop. So, you know, props are good for introverts.
I found that asking a simple question like, you know, tell me about that to people has helped me a lot. In fact, in recent months, I felt that living in the basement of your house and during COVID and stuff, you know, I think we lost some of that art of just asking questions. And I think for everybody, it just helps to just, like you said, you see a conversational piece or someone mentions offhand that they went to the beach this week or something. You know, tell me about that. Like actually try to, and you find that a lot of people in your sphere are more interesting than you give them credit for. And, you know, there you can find a point of commonality. In fact, I've always found that within a couple of minutes, I have something in common with them. Like, you know, I grew up there or I know someone from there or I did that one time or, you know, something. And it just creates a nice connection. I think it's if you just let it go, let it play out a little bit. Don't just, you know, turn your shoulder to them. Actually say facing them and say, tell me more about that. And it's really interesting. So I think these are great tips. I mean, it's you know, like you said, it's not a system. It's just kind of being yourself and, you know, and viewing your sphere as your source of business, but also a source of energy for yourself. I think that's really important. It's not something it's not something you're doing something to. It's something you're getting something from your sphere.
Jennifer, do you find that you know, that strategy that you were just talking about, like having those commonalities with people and having those conversations, also can be done, or you've done that in a way that's on social media? You know, sometimes you can't see everyone every day, but you know, responding and engaging on social media.
That's a whole other show in itself too, especially for introverts.
That's true.
But no. I didn't have social media when I was a real estate agent. If I had, I'd have kicked butt with it. And not because I'm some social media expert. I don't have an Instagram account. I don't Twitter. I never did. But hey, I know Facebook. Posing on them is to me magical. And so, I wish I'd had Facebook, but, so you can build, I mean, we all know you can build relationships with people on social media and, you know, people say you can't. Yeah, hell yes, you can. I have great friends on social media that I've never met, and it's a different kind of friendship than we had growing up, and maybe it's real. Maybe it's not. I think it's pretty real. It's just different. It's different. But, so the big thing about, I'll just say Facebook, but social media is never go on social media promoting your real estate business. Nobody cares and you're going to drive people off. But there's so many things you can do on social media that are all these things we're talking about. I mean, eating sushi and, you know, having commonalities and caring about other people. Almost every bit of it you can do on social media. You just go in with the right heart of, I'm not here to market to people. You know, how do I use Facebook to market my real estate business? You don't. You use it to make connections with people, you know, that you know now or that you will know.
Posting a picture at the local dog park.
Mm-hmm. Oh, there's, I mean, the opportunities to use social media to build a business, but it's not marketing. It's relationship building. And
like you said, it's a whole nother show. It's a whole nother show. We had somebody on recently that was an agent who, you know, decided that she wanted to use social media in a certain channel, and she started doing it. And it was uncomfortable at first, but she tried to focus on being herself. And she found that, you know, she had a lot of views, but only certain people would comment. And she started, you know, commenting back to them and asking them and started talking to them. Like, it's like, imagine the last person that, you know, liked your post. Imagine like messaging them and saying, how are you today? You would never, it's like, that's not how we work. Social media today is just proclamation after proclamation after proclamation. I don't care if it's advertising or political or whatever. There's almost no like, how are you today kind of interactions. Well, but if the opportunity is there though.
You wanted a specific tip, or you want specific tips. So, okay. Go on to Facebook, print out your database. Okay. However many people that is, print out your database, go into Facebook and go into each and every person's profile that's on your database. You can find them, you know, whatever. Look on every single one and scroll down through their posts. Did they say something that interests you that you could comment on intelligently? Do that one day. Just spend all day doing that. And I'm not a social media technological expert, but my guess is, you know, as you go through all these people, it's going to connect you, you know? And so you're going to show up on their feed. They're going to show up on your feed. Suddenly you have this connection, and all you had to do was go on to somebody's, you know, profile, and they talked about their dog dying, I mean, you know, whatever. And you say, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. You know, here's a, one thing I do in the dog rescue is I have pictures of every dog we've rescued back to 2012 from when they were in the shelter. And so when somebody posts something about their dog that they rescued from us, I go through, I dig up the shelter picture and I post it and I say, here's Fancy Pants, you know, from the shelter. And I, you know, it's just little things you can do to make connections, make contacts with people that, you know, they're going to.
Well, also, and social media also has a pre-built, you know, the groups and Facebook. You know, and there's so many, I belong to four or five groups, and, you know, they're lifestyle for me. It's not like, you know, real estate. There's a group called My Real Estate Sphere. It doesn't exist. But, you know, it's the disc golf group and the, you know, whatever group. Right. And, you know, and those people, we have a shared, like, literally any one of them I could talk about this topic.
We're both
passionate about that topic, whatever it is. And everybody has a group or has an environment within social media. There's no, like, gathering out on the street corner for this topic, typically. Maybe once a year or some kind of a convention or something, but usually it's social gives you that pre-built audience of shared interests if you find it.
Exactly. So.
Well, I mean, we could just keep going. This is great, but we got to stop it at some point here. But Jennifer, it's been really great having you on. I think that it's a great regrounding for all of us in the real estate business, and any business really, on how to be ourselves and also, you know, be focused on building a business. And, and by business, I mean, you know, a network of people who would use you and respect you. And so I think it's been great. We'd love to know, you know, how does somebody who's listening to this podcast to, like, find you? What's the best way they can connect to more of your message? I know you're on Amazon and you have a website and stuff, right?
My real estate training website is sellwithsoul.com, sellwithsoul.com. I am in the process of somewhat taking that down because I'm not doing, I mean, I've said everything I have to say. I honestly don't have anything new to say. So my website is there. I'm not super active on it at all. But you're welcome to go to sellwithsoul.com. There is unbelievable amounts of stuff there. What we've just heard, and I mean, just so much there. If you're, you know, want to actually connect with me directly, which I'm happy to do, I really hang out in the dog rescue world. So, you know, Jennifer Allan-Hagedorn, Saving with Soul Pet Rescue. And, you know, that's where you'll find me active and, you know, doing stuff. So come see me.
Wow. That was great. So informative. And so I think for me, the biggest thing was when she talked about making it organic and natural. And I think who can't relate to that? And what's organic and natural for me is going to be different than what's organic and natural for you. So I was thinking about how she was talking about going to lunch with people. And I think, oh, that's easy. But, you know, I think maybe for some people, that's not easy. Maybe guys don't tend to go out to lunch together. Maybe they're going to have a beer together or go play golf together or something like that, or just come on over and watch a game together. So the way you do that might be different for you. But I love the fact that she just said, there's not a formula, just do what you enjoy doing and do it with other people and look to build relationships. And I think that most people can just resonate with that, make it organic and make it natural. And we say that all the time. I know I say that all the time, talking to agents about marketing. Should I do this or should I do that? Or does it feel natural? I mean, you've got to be yourself, whatever that is. If it's crazy weird and you're crazy weird, great. If it's low key and you're low key, the important thing is that it's natural for you.
Yeah, I completely agree. And, you know, it's also interesting that she was talking about the word that stands out for me was mini sphere, because, you know, she's talking about everyone involved in the transaction, the buyer, the seller, the seller's agent, buyer's agent, vendors, mortgage, appraiser, you know, they're all people who, and she said that you're the spotlight of that transaction, right? So everyone's eyes are on you, and your ethics as a realtor, your good job, your professionalism, your kindness, not authenticity, that's seen by everyone involved. And that truly does go a long way, because in the business, you're going to be involved with these people all the time, or maybe again, or maybe they refer you because they really had a great interaction with you. And Jeff, you had said before, you know, one of the things that impressed you the most as an agent back in the day was that you would receive a thank you note from the seller's agent or buyer's agent, and that, you know, you feel like, oh wow, this actually really means a lot, thank you, and you think about that person, and all those little touches and seed plants and interactions are, you know, what's help you make authentic business. That's my biggest takeaway, at least from her.
Yeah, I think that, you know, that this conversation is really important, because there's so many agents that don't consider themselves prospectors. I know I definitely didn't consider myself one. And instead of it being viewed as a cop out, which I think many people in the industry, you know, kind of poo-poo and say, well, I guess you're not cut out for this because you're not willing to call people and go out and get call 20 people and get a buyer today type of attitude. And I think that there's a lot of agents that feel stressed at that. They feel that they're not necessarily in the right industry, and people don't last maybe because they don't think that they can do what's required of them. But I think there's an alternative path that many agents, and I can think of many agents in our own company, and I'm sure anybody listening can think of agents, and they may be one, that haven't gone that route. And they've gone the route of building it one person at a time. And if they applied a formula to that, it would probably be something similar to what Jennifer was sharing if they really were honest with themselves. And I think this is really important that agents feel encouraged. And I think that my only thing I would add to that is that the systemization of the notes and following up on social media with people, like meaning that you look them up and you just see what they're posting about and learn a little bit about them, take a note, and then maybe make a comment and just connect with them. Like that one step of connecting with people, if you multiply it, you know, there's that Japanese principle of Kaizen, which small projects, you know, accomplished with regularity lead to large results. That's the that's a summarization of it. And that's how we do it in this business. If you're not built to call 45 people a day and tell them you're coming over to list their house, there's got to be an alternative. And this is the alternative right here. This is it. And so just finding that for yourself and then applying it is just so big. So it's been a great episode, and I hope you guys enjoyed it. And we will be bringing some more great guests to you in the future episodes of In the Blue Zone.